Good morning. Welcome to this COVID-19 commercial response live stream. My name is Onno Olderman. I'm managing partner at Simon Kucher, responsible for our Dutch and UK practices. We live in exceptional times, so I hope you, your family, and your colleagues are doing well, are in good health, and that you are able to deal with this crisis that we have at hand. From a personal note, I've lived through the crisis of 2000, the bubble, but also the financial crisis of 2009. But this crisis has definitely the most impact to me. The daily lives of my family and all around us are so directly affected that it will stick in my and our memory for a very long time, I believe. And I'm convinced that this crisis will change our lives for the long run. And also the way we do business in the future. But for most, it's a human crisis, and we as leaders have the challenging task of both limiting casualties as well as safeguarding the income for families. In the next hour, my colleagues and I will present to you our view on the current crisis and come up with practical short-term and intermediate strategies for companies to deal with this crisis. We as Simon Kucher, we are market leaders in the top line space, and we've assembled for this live stream our thought leadership from our 39 offices worldwide, yet colored with a Dutch and personal touch. So we are in good company here today. Here you see some of the names of the people participating, or at least the companies. As we, of course, cannot mention the personal names. You come from different industries, from consumer goods, from retail, from manufacturing, to travel, to transportation, to banking, and so forth. So for our session today, this means that we'll have examples of multiple industries, not just your own, but I'm confident you can have inspiration from both. Speaker-wise, after my introduction, I will hand over to my partner colleague, Hongmei Cheng, a partner at our Amsterdam office, who will share his views and practical cases on how to cope with the short-term effects of the downturn. He will share his ideas on how to stay close to your customers and protect revenues, also how to implement smart sales and pricing measures to protect margins, and how to accelerate the rollout of digital sales and delivery models. Hereafter, my partner colleague Juriaan Deumer will share his views and practical cases on how to prepare for recovery. For example, how to anticipate post-crisis market landscape and the target growth areas, but also how to adjust your commercial offering and revenue model, and as a consequence, how to restructure your commercial operating model and realigning your resources. But first, let me start with the context and commercial symptoms of this crisis. I thought that this assembly of pictures is the best illustration of the life you have currently. You see here the pictures taken by the BBC on April 2nd at noon. Amsterdam Leidse Straat, empty. Paris Eiffel Tower, empty. Venice canals, empty. So what you see here is a symbolic demonstration of how life as we know it came to a standstill. These are the immediate effects. We are at the beginning of a crisis, and business is affected. Three messages I would like to convey in the next 50 minutes. First is how to deal with the acute mobility freeze, demand shock, risk aversion. Second, how to prepare for the recovery and the changed business environment. And third, how to practice early and decisive countermeasures for you and your segment. So, but let me first talk about the current situation, because we are at the start of the pandemic. The casualties are rising every day. We get number addicted, many of us. With these rising numbers, it's devastating to see. 200 plus countries have imposed restrictive measures to society, and that's heavily affecting businesses. Now, most experts indicate that only a revolutionary treatment or a vaccine will remove the restrictive measures per country. and that's at least 9 months from now. So that means for the upcoming 9 months, we'll have globally still many restrictive measures to be installed affecting our businesses. So there's a short-term impact, but definitely there's also a long-term impact for all of us. What are the short-term impacts? The short-term impacts, first of all, is the mobility freeze. What is a mobility freeze? Suppliers struggle to meet commitments, impacting your offering to the market. Second, the reduced ability to service customers with your remote workforce, which of course impacts all of us. Third, it's the reduced traffic in physical purchase channels. Why is that an issue? Just like in times when you're single, you need the events to find your partner. And in business, it's the same. It means you need to meet your customers at fairs and conferences and personal meetings. And that's what we're used to in many of our cultures worldwide. A second important symptom of this crisis is demand shock, which means significant decline in demand results, in excess capacity and inventory. Second, surging demand in selected categories, which creates short-term supply shortages, but also the prospect of supply chain issues, which lead to stockpiling and forecast issues. Third, there is the risk aversion. We feel it. The confidence is decreasing every day, and there's an acute reluctance to commit to investments due to current uncertainty. Large orders and projects are being canceled, but also a lot of payments are being postponed, which affects all of our businesses and liquidities. So the mobility freeze, demand shock, and the risk aversion are the first acute symptoms of this crisis. Now, it differs per industry, as we all know it. And there are the outliers. The outliers that are having this incredible demand drop. Think about airlines, travel, tourism, leisure, apparel, meat, retail. Then we have the other side of companies who have surging demand with sudden fulfillment challenges, such as food retail, grocery, and pharma. By the way, food retail is now more or less stabilizing. I think most of what we did on forward buying as consumers is now in closets. So also there it's stabilizing. My point is that in between those outliers, you have US companies, the vast majority, who ask themselves four questions. How deep will the crisis be in the next coming 3 to 4 months? How quickly will we recover? And will we get back to our normal revenue levels? And then fourth, what are the scenarios here? It's very important to do scenario planning. And for that reason, you need to set up your crisis response team. Many of you have done that. I think all of you have done that. But there is a next step. And the next step is to formulate your commercial crisis response team, who looks ahead and plans ahead and forecasts demand and revenue scenarios, including the impact on key account management, outbound sales, your pricing, differentiated, and marketing. And typically, these teams align twice a week. Why twice a week? Because that's our average. Some teams do it daily, some customers do it weekly, but on average, it's twice a week. So we've asked you also your current view on the crisis. And the conclusion is you see rough seas ahead, not surprisingly. If you look on the, let's say on the left side of this graph, you see our mood, which is mostly pessimistic, but also some optimism. And the optimism is especially in what we call the tech and software space, where quite a few are neutral to slightly positive in this segment. Whereas in consumer retail, most of you are more pessimistic. So not surprisingly. We've asked you, and I think that's interesting to look at, what your expectation is over the next 3 months for your revenues. And on average, you expect a 26% decrease of revenues for that short term. But you're more positive about year end, because there, on average, you expect a 16% decrease of your revenues in comparison to last year. And that's of course interesting. Yeah, there is everybody expect that there will be Q4 a comeback of the way we've lived our business. And the question, of course, is if that's the case. But for most, I think all the predictions from CBS, our Dutch statistical body, should be improved, because 60% is not the figure they're using currently, but it will be closer to reality for this year, we expect. What's there to expect in the long run? Of course, the duration of the COVID crisis is typically seen as or a V curve or a W curve or an L curve. You've all read and seen that. Just to recap, V curves assume that there will be a relatively short economical dip from where we'll afterwards quite soon get back to our growth as we have had it until now. Examples are the past viral epidemics. The U curve assumes that although we expect a recovery, we will have a permanent loss of output in our GDP due to the crisis. An example of that is the oil crisis of 1970s. A L curve assumes a structural damage to economy with a significant impact on growth. So examples are Japan in the 19s, but also Greece with the latest financial crisis. Now, what is currently going on? Currently, our clients in China are seeing first signs of recovery. Glimpse of light, which could indicate a V curve. However, as I indicated before, this crisis has just started on an immense global scale. A vaccine will not arrive, as indicated, before 2021. And meanwhile, governments will have spent enormous amounts of liquidity to support businesses to a debt ratio beyond imagination. I mean, in US, it's $2 trillion dollars. Also, the European Union is ramping up. Italy this week indicated they would like to inject 400 billion euros into our economy. So the impact on our economies will be enormous for the next 6 months. As such, if you look at this graph, a U curve is more likely than a V curve. Now, what are the long-term trends? We believe that the long-term impact will be there, and there will be two trends for certain. First, we'll have the acceleration of digitalization. Why? Because compared to 2019, society fear will permanently result in decreased physical movement. Second, consumers are fast-tracked educated on informing, ordering, and being serviced online. And third, increased shifts in all sectors towards the digital channel, both B2C and B2B, will enhance digitalization. Second large trend is deglobalization, or better, a slowdown in globalization. Why? Governments will selectively nationalize, but are expected for sure to increase control over vital functions in society, learning lessons from this crisis. Business will need to adapt and need to be able to fine-tune their local needs and regulations. This means also that supply chain, demand allocations, and pricing will experience more local constraints and specifics. These are long-term trends. What can you do about it? We'll share a lot of examples here today. Also, Homei and Yuri will do it in a minute. But let me share just three examples. I like the one of Starbucks, where they took the crisis of 2000 to move and stimulate the proportion of licensed outlets because it was the right moment. So they took advantage of that crisis to stimulate this piece, where they went from 7% in 1998 to 23% in 2000. And this really led to their expansion, international expansion, and their growth. And currently, alliances contribute to 14% of the company's revenues, but account for 39% of their profits. Second example is Cargotec, an international crane company They had intense low-cost competition and went, they just changed the revenue model. They went from a fixed price for the machinery to charging per move of the crane. This made, first of all, price comparison more difficult, but for most, they could better monetize their value, which they had in comparison to their competition. Last example, AutoZone. Great example. They are a leading manufacturer in the automotive aftermarket, or supplier in the automotive aftermarket, I should say. And they experienced heavy demand drops. And after the immediate cost measure, which all of us should be doing and looking at, they applied differentiation on prices and services during the uptake and outgrew their competitors after crisis by more than 9%. These three cases are my cliffhanger for my colleagues Hongmei and Yurian. They will share more case examples with you in the next half hour. These are the areas. So first of all, Hongmei will talk about the short-term stabilization measures you can take to protect revenues. And thereafter, Yurian will share some thoughts and best practices on dealing with restructuring your commercial focus and operating model when recovery kicks in. That's it from my end. I'll hand over to Hongmei. Hongmei, the live stream floor is yours.
In these past few initial weeks of the crisis, I trust that many of you have completed your scenario modeling and have taken initial cost reduction measures where required. Now is the time to look ahead, to ensure we keep externally focused on our markets and customers. Because also in these times, and in particular these times, continuous, creative, and systematic actions are required to protect our revenue and top-line driven income. For that, I would like to share three action areas for the short and immediate term. First of all, relationships are built in times of crisis. This requires two actions. First of all, we need to reevaluate and assess the value of our full customer base. This requires us to look into factors such as, for example, customer loyalty, but also customer profitability, also in the light of changing channel behavior, customers shifting from offline to online channels. Also, future importance and growth potential need to be taken into account. And also in that, we need to model the impact which COVID-19 has on these factors and the composition of our customer base. With these insights, we can ensure we allocate our scarce sales resources where they matter most, to our key accounts. There, we need to be super proactive in understanding their concerns and their needs. We need to be very responsive on their questions, their issues, their risks. And we need to be very company-specific and tailored with offering solutions and offerings to help them through this difficult time. And with that, we will help them to ensure to survive this crisis, to join them hand in hand, and to be ready when the recovery kicks in. And the key word in that is attention. And attention starts with understanding our customer demands, understanding their risks, their needs, and how these are changing in times of crisis. And upon that, we can take targeted measures. We can offer solutions. And we can witness many apathetic examples of that in our daily life around us. For example, with regards to over-delivery and service, at the moment we see banks proactively reaching out to companies and customers to actually defer their installment payment on mortgages or loans. With regard to cancellation policies, we see that Airbnb is working together with homeowners to replace the partial refund policy with a 100% money back guarantee. And also, extending payment terms might give temporary relief in this difficult time. But it can also be a source of proving additional value and defining new propositions. And that brings me to Hyundai. In 2009, Hyundai launched their Peace of Mind program, which was basically offered customers to, when they would lose their jobs within 6 months, bring back the car and get their money back. It was a key pillar in the Great Crisis and actually allowed Hyundai to become a mainstream brand in the 10 years to come in the US. 2 months ago, they kicked back this program. Small changes. For example, currently you get up to 6 months payment relief if you lose your job, but moreover, all customers can request a free 4-month delay of their payment requests. And with that, this is not a charity case, but actually a sound and well thought through economic offering with an underlying insurance. And I think this is a great example of a company and a proposition showing empathy in combination with a customer-centric and economically sound offering. Additionally, across the board, we need to make sure that we push sales. Attention is required in every step of the sales cycle, just as a normal business, but in particular also these steps in these times. Small changes here can combined yield significant impact. And a few of these things I trust you already do every day, but then again, some points require specific attention. Converting cold leads into hot leads is very difficult in these remote times, workers being at home. Now we need to double down our attention on our existing customers, our key accounts, our existing relationships, there where we already are proving our value or have proven our value. We need to make sure that we work with those customers hand in hand to prove additional value, to also signal potential upsell or cross-sell opportunities, to help them through this period and protecting our revenue at the same time and positioning us for the future recovery to come. Secondly, with regard to win rate, it's super important to increase our conversion rate on the leads which we currently already have on our table. We need to double down our resources on those leads to make sure we have all our scarce attention there where it matters most. And for sure, your people may be at home, but install virtual win rooms to make sure that we have all our creativity around us to make sure we can get those customers converted and also are able to prove our value to them. And thirdly, we need to make sure that our executives are pulled away from internal meetings and also remain client-facing to ensure that they are there in critical deals to make the small difference and to increase our conversion. With regards to risk aversion, we need to be very creative. Think proactively. Remove any risks and obstacles which actually may delay your conversion time or delay the decision at all. Be creative here. Think about, for example, flexible payment options, offer free trials, proactive client references to make sure that you increase the conversion and your value delivery at the end. Aside from keeping volume up, also keeping prices up and protecting margins is key in this period. And four topics I would like to discuss for that matter. Guiding principle here is, as always, adhere to a fair and defendable pricing policy. But in particular in these times, corporate responsibility here is key. Many customers in this period approach me with the question, should I actually lower my prices or increase my promotional intensity in this period? And in general, the answer is no. In many companies, volumes are under pressure and price elasticity is declining in many sectors, which means that actually reducing prices will yield hardly to no volume uplift. Moreover, combining a volume drop with a price drop will actually double the negative effect as is displayed in this graph. It will may cause a potential negative spiral and may risk a potential price war. So advice here, keep prices stable where you can, prevent unintended price wars, and there where you have to do a price cut, do it surgically, well thought through. For example, elements of your portfolio which are end of life, or in certain segments or regions where it's defendable. And this should always be a management decision. And above all, also in these difficult times, be able and willing to accept volume cuts before price cuts. In this period, that might also help to bring actually production capacity or stock levels down to ensure you reduce sales pressure and the hunger for volume. And that's exactly what the champagne producers did in 2009. The expected volume in 2009 was 270 million bottles, which is actually 21% lower compared to 2008. And in 2009, based on that, growers decided to burn 1/3 of their stock. By that, they were able to stabilize volumes, keep prices up, and keep margins healthy. Not only during the times of crisis, but in particular also to have a healthy starting position in the recovery phase and post-crisis period. And currently we can witness the same situation in the horticulture market, where in Africa, for example, growers are burning their roses and flowers to prevent overcapacity in the market. Secondly, we need to prevent that we get into a situation where we have to give discounts to warrant any volumes at all. Consider less expensive alternatives. What does it mean? Consider to debundle your product. Perhaps you can take out features, you can take out service levels to, yeah, let's call it, to create a good enough offer. Or let's call it a degraded option for a degraded budget, which allows you to protect actually the positioning and the price and the margin you deserve and the costs you are making for your standard and your premium offering, while offering a solution which actually fits to the current budget constraints. For that, it's super important to actually understand these budget restrictions fact-based, not on gut feel. And believe me, cost reductions can be quantified just as easily as willingness to pay and budget restrictions. Advice there, relaunch your market research, apply best-in-class methods, and make sure that you have a short turnaround time of that. 3 to 4 weeks, you need to have the facts in quickly to be able to act upon that. An example is showed on the picture from Westendorp. Is a type of analysis which is basically gives you answer on 4 questions. When is my new offering in terms of price too cheap? When is it affordable, expensive, or too expensive? That gives you a good idea of the price window, the ideal launch area to position your new less expensive alternative. In addition, it will give you insight into price thresholds. To illustrate that, in this example, you will see that between 100 and 130 euros, the curve is quite flat. We call that a stable area. There you have price room. Basically, you could increase the prices from 100 to 130 euros without sacrificing volumes. On the other hand, at 140 euros here, you see a drop area and price anchor. Beyond that point, volumes would drop significantly and probably a price increase would not compensate for that. So the ideal positioning for this less expensive alternative in this example would probably be around 139 euros, assuming that you want to optimize volumes, revenues, and profits at the same time. Also, this might be a good time to restructure and simplify your product portfolio. Too often I see complex, technical-driven, very inside-out propositions. Difficult to understand, no clear onboarding or upsell path. And in these times where offline sales with salespeople has changed to a digital environment where people self-select their solution, simplicity has become even more important. And this may be a good time to replace this old portfolio with a new, clean, simple, and customer-centric layout of your portfolio structure, with a clear land and expand strategy, which offers an entry offering in this times of crisis for customers and solutions which require budget restrictions, whilst having a clear cross and upsell path ready when the time is right, when the recovery kicks in. Third point is that we want to increase attention to our high margin categories. On those products or product categories where we are different, where we have a special value add, where we stand out in the market, and also where our margin performance is higher. Increasing the market share of those products will increase the market performance of your full portfolio. And we need to support sales for that purpose. It might well be that not the full sales force is able to actually sell those type of products. Train them, give them value selling argumentation to be able to be also sell that part of your portfolio and also to have cross-sell and upsell in place, again, to drive up the market share of those high margin categories, which at the same time provide additional value to our customers. Fourth point with regards to prices is discount policies. In particular, in these times, we want to prevent that discounts are being uncontrolled in a negative spiral. And the typical picture we see is displayed here, where there's no correlation between the size of the customer and actually the net price of the discount they get. Discounts are often historically grown, cost plus, unconditional, with lack of grip and monitoring. A piece of advice here is, for example, start with implementing and minimum net prices. Assure to prevent outliers per customer segment. Do not allow prices to go beyond that point. Secondly, make discounts conditional, meaning tit for tat, asking something in return. For example, for sure you can get a higher discount, but then we, for example, need to increase cross-sell in certain categories, or get volume commitments, or change payment terms. Conditionality of your discounts is important to also ensure the defendability of those discounts between different customer segments. And lastly, again here, value selling trainings are key. Keep your salespeople together. Ensure that you exchange knowledge for counter-argumentation and also best practices and tips, actually to also give answers to customers which do not necessarily relate to discounts. Aside from keeping your volumes and your prices up, this may also be the time to accelerate on your strategic initiatives, in particular with regards to your digital footprint. Many companies at the moment witness a full demand drop and collapse for their physical channels. And for many industries, this shift to digital will be permanent. And companies need to have a digital strategy in place with explicit ideas how to monetize and be relevant in this new omnichannel environment. You need to accelerate the rollout of your digital sales and delivery model to anticipate the structural and permanent channel shift. And of course, this is not new to you, because in your annual research, we already see that 80% of you are already heavily investing in digital in the last few years. Actually, 75% of you are also confirming that they are doing this to increase top line, to increase revenue, to increase value add and relevance to the customers. But at the same time, nearly 80% of you says that they don't see any impact. So costs are being added to the company, technical complexity is being added. On the other hand, no value add or potential for customers is positioned or monetized. And why? Because 9 out of 10 companies confirms that they do not have a commercial or pricing strategy in place to monetize their digital roadmap, to monetize and bring their digital roadmap to life for the customers. And now is the time to turn these hidden gems, all these digital investments, into relevant value add, into propositions to add value to your customer segments and actually also to monetize that as you originally intended to. That brings me to my last example. In 2012, Uber entered the UK market. Edison Lee, a UK-based transport company, let's call it a taxi company, witnessed a 25% demand drop based on that market entry. What they did is they reinvented the digital offering, a new promotional strategy online to win back customer demand, to reboost also volumes coming in, and also to stimulate their omnichannel footprint. And they had some very smart, well thought through initiatives for that in place as well. For example, a £10 voucher upon app download to again get acquisition in, but also to stimulate the omnichannel footprint. Another example, for example, is that they also kicked in a £10 discount upon the 4th trip you booked with them online to get beyond the habitual threshold that people get used to booking with them in a different environment. So a few learnings from that. Most important, do not copy your offline portfolio, your offline strategy to an online environment. Make sure that you have a specific offering and pricing strategy in place for your digital dynamics. Secondly, ensure that you have a dedicated sales team in place to have professional and personalized online lead generation in place and also to drive structured up and cross-selling. Digital success will not come by investing more money in it. It will come by having a well thought through strategy in place, smart ideas like Edison Lee had to make sure that we turn this around into actual value. With that, I hope that I've given you a few ideas to actually stabilize your performance for the short and for the immediate term. Jurriaan will discuss his ideas for the midterm recovery to come hopefully shortly. Jurriaan, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Romee. Being in the fourth week of lockdown in the Netherlands, we see the discussion about an exit strategy coming up, but also we see companies moving from pure crisis management into preparing for another phase, being ramp up and recovery. And they're right to do so. We also think, apart from the measures that Homay just pointed out, now is the time to work on the next step and to prepare your company, your commercial organization, for a period of continued disruption intervals. In the next session, I would like to highlight three topics in this process, in the areas of commercial strategy, your commercial operating model, and your commercial offering. Starting with the commercial strategy, it's important to anticipate and assess the post-crisis market landscape, which will probably be different than before. The current COVID-19 measures will continue to have an impact on your market. And as Onno pointed out in the introduction, this will heavily differ per sector. Nonetheless, we believe that a couple of key questions are important to answer, such as how have current measures and will current measures impact the attractiveness of your countries and growth segments, and how will that shift? In your value chain, how will the balance of power shift, and what opportunities for back and forward integration will emerge? When looking at your competitors, how have they come through, how have they coped with the current situation? What are winners, but also what are losers, and what M&A opportunities have come up? And finally, when looking at your customers, what has changed in their preferences and their needs, and how would you like to service them via which channel, either direct or indirect? In redefining the commercial direction, it will be useful to consider and combine two dimensions. On the one hand, the horizontal axis being the external dimension, the impact on your sector dynamics. As said just before, to what extent will your sector dynamics have changed based on a continued period of lockdown? The other dimension is the vertical axis, the internal dimension, which is your company's resilience. To what extent has your company been impacted and hit by the current measures? The combined assessment of these two dimensions provide insight into possible commercial strategy scenarios, from redesigning your commercial strategy, the bottom right corner, to right-sizing your commercial organization, the top left corner, or a combination of both, which could imply a reinvention of your commercial business model. Given the deep and structural impact of COVID-19, we believe the bottom left scenario to be highly unlikely. We will probably not return to business as usual in the coming months or even the coming year. And this implies a need for commercial adaptation in the market approach and or your commercial organization. And we expect a relatively normal period in coming months that provide an excellent time horizon to start thinking about to prepare your commercial organization for continued longer term disruption intervals afterwards. So how to approach this? We suggest to set up a multidisciplinary ramp-up team, a plan-ahead team, so to say, to together assess the post-crisis market landscape, do some basic analysis on your core markets. Then organize a series of strategy workshops with your ramp-up team, but also with your salespeople who, given current travel restrictions, should have some time at hand. Then redefine the commercial direction, shortlist relevant scenarios, and define the most likely one. Finally, translate insights and results into a rollout plan. Define actions, define milestones based on social and economical trigger points. To illustrate this, let's take a look at how other companies have coped or are coping with this. For example, Starbucks, although already referred to it as an example from the 2000 crisis, now let's take a look at the 2008 crisis. During the financial crisis, sales volume of Starbucks was severely hit as customers were choosing cheaper options for their daily coffee needs. And as opposed to lowering prices, Starbucks changed its market approach. It moved from a more inside-out orientation to an outside-in orientation. It invested in IT to support that. It invested heavily in social media promotions, thereby improving its brand image, as such justifying the premium it asks for the coffee it makes. So Starbucks came out of the crisis stronger by taking the right action. Another example, more for the current period. We've been doing a lot of work in 3D printing in the past couple of years, and we've seen the sector become more and more mature. We've got more and more companies realizing the benefits of being able to print parts locally. In the current situation, given supply chain disruptions causing shortages of spare parts globally, we see 3D printers being in high demand. And the question for 3D manufacturers, 3D printer manufacturers, of course, is, after this initial peak in volume, will this be the final breakthrough, a real breakthrough of 3D printing worldwide? And what are the implications for these manufacturers when planning further ahead and looking at their commercial focus, their propositions, and their pricing? As a next step, of course, in case of a strategic redirection or a structurally impacted commercial operation, it's also important to realign your commercial operating model. And two elements I would like to highlight that are particularly important. In the first place, your people and your structure. What is the impact of current and continued lockdown interventions on how your commercial organization is set up? Which temporary or more long-term adjustments need to be made to people, structure, or your sales team? Secondly, processes and enablers. How do you stay on top of your sales activities and your sales performance when you're working remotely? How do you optimally equip the sales force to be able to effectively sell when they went from being outside sales reps to inside sales overnight? And how do you prepare them to sell remotely in cases of continued lockdowns in the future? And here, of course, the hard part will be about balancing short-term and long-term, making tough decisions in the short-term, if needed, without hurting your revenue model in the future. And during the past few weeks, most of you already have probably made adjustments to your commercial setup, allowing them to work remotely, still being effective. In preparation for a ramp-up, it's also time to plan further ahead and assess the impact of a strategic redirection. Again, we have captured this in a three-stage approach. Define the design principles, define the impact on your commercial operating model, make changes in processes, in structure, in team, and in responsibilities. And finally, execute. And as opposed to redefining the strategic direction, this is probably more a management responsibility following a top-down approach. Again, an example to illustrate how companies react to changing market dynamics by altering their operating model. For example, we have been working and we are working a lot for manufacturers, preparing them for the arrival of Amazon. And what we notice, what we observe, is that Amazon typically requires a couple of things from its suppliers, which could be improved product availability, investments in digital activation, but also harmonized pricing across countries from its manufacturers. And what we see is that this causes traditional manufacturers' operating model to be challenged, why they're organized locally and just not set up to cater companies like Amazon from a cross-country perspective. So one solution direction is to move to a more centralized key account management model, thereby being able to service a customer like Amazon and prevent revenue leakage. Finally, it's also time to critically and creatively rethink your commercial offering. As since the all-time priority in a crisis is to reduce cost and manage liquidity, the commercial response should be to help customers buy also under conditions like these. And not just by throwing discounts at them, thereby hurting margins in the short term and possibly value monetization in the longer term, as Homme already pointed out. A couple of examples of how you could do that. For example, you could consider moving from one-off to subscription pricing, thereby spreading the payment over a longer period of time. Another option could be to offer free trials, allowing customers to experience the full product and service value before making the final buying decision. And another idea is to tie payment to usage, thereby aligning more closely to the value delivered and moving CapEx to OpEx. And although some of the examples shown here might seem more oriented towards B2C customers. There's actually plenty of examples that show that this can be successful in B2B environments as well. Take, for example, Michelin, an example from a couple of years ago. Michelin's tires were traditionally priced at a premium using a traditional model of pricing by tire, in which case the customer bears the upfront cost of the tire as well as the risk of replacement. The proposition of Michelin in this model was to be a traditional tire manufacturer. But they found out that the monetization of the added value of the premium tires they supply was difficult. The change they made was to move from a tire manufacturer to a solution provider, changing their price metric from price per tire to price per kilometer, and by doing so, automatically monetizing a higher price for the superior value delivered, and thereby lowering barriers to buy. So, Homay and I have been speaking about 6 commercial response measures for the current crisis. Some of them are more focused on the short term, some of them are more focused on preparing for ramp up and recovery. But all of them have a clear call to action beyond just cost cutting. And we hope to have given you some new ideas and some new insights. Onno, back to you.
Thank you, Juriaan. Thank you for this outline. Yeah, one last message we would like to convey today is all the measures we have shared have one thing in common. They need to support the long-term existence of your company. And that's a leadership task, which has an economical factor, but for most a human factor to this. When we are dealing with customers, employees, suppliers, and society. So opportunistic sales and pricing behavior will be punished. Looking from a positive side, there are very good examples right now in the market on how companies are acting as role models, such as Albert Heijn in retail, doing so much more in store for their consumers, MedTech, Philips, for their machines, how they allocate it, how they communicate to the market on their allocation and their social concern. And yes, even banks, Rabobank, the CEO, who clearly indicated that they have also a responsibility in this crisis to support businesses. That leadership task will be essential for all of us to recover out of this crisis. Good, that's the part from us. Well, if you need help, we'll find a way together. I see we have quite some questions coming in. We'll pick those up with you after the session. We'll make sure that we have direct feedback on those. For now, I would like to say we can support you if required on senior sparring workshop for commercial leadership, otherwise expert injections for your commercial response teams, but also we can accelerate your strategic initiatives to prepare you for recovery out of this crisis. Good, that's it from my end and my colleagues. I wish you a wonderful day in good health for you, your family, and your colleagues in the next period. Goodbye.